My name is Sam Dickson. I'm a lawyer, a real estate investor, and I'm a native born American. I'm pretty much a founding stock American. I have only one set of ancestors who arrived after the revolution. I'm one quarter German. I had two great grandparents who came to America in 1848 from Schleswig-Holstein after the failure of the German Revolution. So I'm a Southerner. I grew up in the South. I like the South. I'm not a Southron. I don't believe in Southern independence. I define myself as a racial communitarian or racial identitarian or a racial idealist. Any three of those would describe me. Politically, I'm a white nationalist. I want an ethnostate for my own people. I think we have the same right to an ethnostate that Jews demand for themselves. I'm not a conservative. I'm not a right winger. One of the little drums that I beat on is to oppose people on our side calling themselves right wingers or alt-right or part of the right or conservative. I think that's harmful to us on many, many levels.
Right on. So part of the agenda of my podcast is to try to encourage people within our movement who feel pessimistic, and it can be overwhelming because it's a kind of a David and Goliath feeling with society. And so I guess before we get into the other questions, why do you do what you do? What motivates you? Why do you care about white people? Why not just live your life and just you know, be under the radar and get rich and just buy property in Vail and ski every day? Who cares? Why do you care about white people in the future of America?
Well, that's a very good question. There's no question I could have made a lot more money and had a lot easier life if I had not gotten into these causes at a very early age. I got involved at age 15. But I can't imagine living a life not being involved. I feel an intense feeling of loyalty to my own people. I've always felt that. And my own people is broadly defined as well as narrowly defined. I'm talking about the white Christian European people as a whole, as well as the particular little variant that I find myself to be an immediate member of, that is Americans who are Southerners. I just can't imagine not feeling that. If you're loyal to your own, you'll support them. A parent who can look with indifference on the suffering of his children is a monster. And to me, race is family in a larger sense. And to be able to look with indifference, as a relative of mine told me he does, on the prospect that the Parthenon could just be ground up to make cement to provide more housing for more alien immigrants to Greece, I just can't imagine functioning like that. It'd be like going to a Little League game and knowing that the coach is a pederast and is going to molest the Little League players, and just sitting there and hanging out with everybody and cheering the game on and doing nothing to protect the children. I just can't imagine people who are able to function like that. But most people are, especially in America, which, as we were talking before the podcast began, are excessively individualistic.
That's one of the main reasons I was very fascinated and eager to talk to you, because again, as we talked before the podcast, you had brought a perspective I'd never heard before about, you know, growing up, I've always heard that as Americans, we were pioneers, we're individualists, we're optimistic. And even my Japanese ex-girlfriend is one of the ones who told me that's what separates us from Europe. And so it's not just American propaganda. Other people around the world see that in us and see, wow, you're very individualistic, you're optimistic. And I'd always worn that as a badge of honor. And you had brought up an example in one of your speeches that if you were the king and you wanted to set up a new colony, you would just take a random city and implant it in America, because what we did is we artificially selected for people who, and I love your phrasing of this as well, you said, who feel suffocated by community. And I was like, that is exactly, that's exactly how I feel, because now I'm dating a Russian girl and they're very big on family. And I just noticed that it feels weird. I'm just so, I don't want to say antisocial, I'm very social, but you know, you're just very, I like my privacy, I just like to be alone, and Russians is very community-based, and it just caused a lot of issues. And so now I see how this has led to a lot of the problems that we face with identity politics going on in America and people not really, I guess whites specifically, not caring about their, we're the only ones who don't care about our tribe, our nation, whatever. We just, you know, it's the bug man thing. We just want to, it's consumerism. We just, what makes me happy? Just the nihilism, just like simple pleasures, just how can I have the maximum amount of pleasure and orgasms and drugs? And I think that stems from this. So I take both good and bad. I'm proud of the pioneer aspect, but I understand there's issues with it. So I guess from your perspective, you had called yourself a racial communitarian. Can you give a little more emphasis and kind of elaborate on that?
Communitarianism is thought of as a left-wing phenomenon. It is a movement. But the communitarians themselves have found that communitarianism doesn't work in racially mixed communities. You probably are familiar with the book Bowling Alone. I think it was by a guy named Robert Putnam. But he sat on this book for some years. He is a leading figure among communitarians because he found the findings of his research were so negative to what he wanted to believe about all races mingling and diversity. But basically, they found that when there is a community of diverse groups, public trust declines, and people are unwilling to put money into school systems and public parks, and they don't feel a sense of community. I'm not a right winger, and I'm not a conservative. I'm not a liberal or a communist either. I simply like de Gaulle and a famous issue. You probably have heard this story, but it's worth remembering. It says a lot. That when de Gaulle was running for re-election the last time as the president of the Republic of France, he was in a runoff against the leftists, and he made a statement. People ask, is de Gaulle on the left? No. Is de Gaulle on the right? No. Is de Gaulle in the center? No. De Gaulle is above. And people tell this story as an example of de Gaulle's colossal ego, but no, he's absolutely right. You know, we as a Frenchman, he was above these ideological, philosophical, political discords, discordant elements in the population. And he was interested in the people of France. And so I believe in private property. I don't think socialism works. It certainly didn't work in the Soviet Union behind the Iron Curtain. But by the same token, I believe that the common good comes ahead of individual self-interest and that where individual self-interest and capitalism conflict with the interests of the community and the race, then the interests of the community and the race come first. And in that sense, I'm a socialist.
So I absolutely agree. And I think part of why there's a suicide epidemic that's unique to the white race in America is because we've lost that sense of living for a higher purpose. We don't have religion. We don't have nationality. We can't be proud of our gender, anything, like nothing, not even our history. And so I do believe this materialistic kind of view of the world is wrong. And so I definitely support that. But to kind of push back against you a little bit, you had said, I think it was in the same speech, the way you were talking about the kinds of artificial selection of the founding stock of America, I think you used the phrase, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you said gypsy-like. And I think that is pretty accurate. It's these people who just don't care, and they're willing to risk dying. And I think you had said, you know, over small things, about just splitting hairs about ideologies, about the, you know, Protestantism and all this. And so I think this is true. And I think as Americans, we need to look in the mirror and be introspective and realize the negative impacts of our individualism and pioneerism. But I was watching a YouTuber by the name of Asha Logos, and he has a series called Subverted History. And he was talking about the before, I guess you could call them Proto-Europeans, I don't really know, but it was the Scythians that I guess branched out into all the different more, you know, the Aryan and all the different like subspecies of white people. And he was describing how historians view their culture. And they were Stoicists before Stoicism or around the same time. And he talked about how they really, again, and I think it goes in line with not being super materialistic. They were very anti-materialistic, and they were nomadic people, and they were warrior people, and one could say that that's quintessentially a white thing, you know. And this newer thing about being stationary is not true to our true nature. So I guess, what are your thoughts on that? Where do you find the balance? How do you, like, where do you draw the line of a healthy willingness to explore, you know, the Faustian spirit, but also the healthy balance of understanding community and living beyond yourself and loyalty to your tribe?
Well, I think that the two go hand in hand. That I think there's much more in common than there is in conflict between the individual and the community. Kipling had in one of his poems the statement that the strength of the pack is in the wolf, and the strength of the wolf is in the pack. And I think that's true. An individual alone is nothing. If you were alone in the forest of New Guinea, what would you have? You'd have nothing. You know, the Greeks had the saying, ik aner, uk aner, one man, no man. And that was a much healthier approach to it. We are part of a community. Our individualism expresses itself only as part of a community. But the community has to come first. You know, the biological, and I say this as a childless man, to somebody that I hope will have children, and the listeners will have children or already have children. But, you know, we are meant to reproduce ourselves. We are meant to create another generation and subordinate our own interests to those of our children. The relationship of parent and child, as the sociologist Sumner said, is the one instance in nature where animals subordinate their personal interest to the interest of somebody else. And I think it's only in that people find meaning. I don't think these childless, gypsy-like people that I hang out with in the bar association and the practice of law and that kind of thing, I just don't think they have full lives. I don't think I have a full life. And my life is much richer than their lives. Their lives are really trivial, getting more toys, going on a trip. You know, I wonder what they will think when they reach old age, as we all will, and their death is approaching, and they have nothing but seven or eight expensive automobiles in their background. What will they think? I mean, they don't live life intensely like you and I do. That's an advantage to our belonging to this movement, is that we live life intensely, and we're not confined to one generation. You and I have a lot of friends. We have friends like Grand Duke Dmitry Donskoy in Russia, where you're living, or Seneca or Homer. You know, we have friends that are drawn from thousands of years, and we have friends around the globe, and we have something to live for. These empty people, I call them, the living dead. They are the living dead. They look with pity upon us because we do suffer sometimes, but I look with pity upon them. They have nothing.
Couldn't have said it better myself. So that makes me, again, to kind of push back and play devil's advocate, I was arguing with actually some family members recently about this, that I think, and again, I think it's our duty to be introspective and not just kind of get caught up and have this groupthink mentality and just, you know, follow what our subculture says. So one of the things that I was thinking about, and that the way they view my, I guess, enthusiasm about, you know, saving white people and the future of America, it sounds like to them, and these are older family members I was talking to, it sounds just like people in the 60s, you know, who are just real radical hippies and or people, I think there was a religious movement revival in the late 70s, early 80s, and, you know, people come and go, and it just seems like another fad, another movement, and I think humans, we naturally think that there's going to be this huge catastrophic event, you know, the global warming or climate change, or I guess in the 70s there's the ice age, or during the 60s it was the Cold War, nuclear war. So I guess, what makes this different? How do you know what you're doing actually matters? And obviously I'm saying this as someone who believes it. I think it does matter, but who's to say that what we're passionate about is any different? How do we know that what we're doing actually matters versus the climate change or versus the global warming and the people in the 60s who thought there was going to be nuclear war at any minute, and they were doing everything and they're sacrificing for this? Like, why? How do you know?
Well, for one thing, we share many of their concerns. That's another reason why I say I'm not a conservative. I am concerned about global warming. I think it is taking place. But as a person who believes in reality, which I think is something that separates us from highly ideologized people who are committed to a philosophical program, we derive our understanding from nature and from natural law. And the theirs just it doesn't stand up. And they themselves are prisoners of their ideology. The global warming is, if it's taking place, and I suspect it is, it's not an issue I want to get involved with. I hope people listening to this will not get distracted by this, because we can't handle every issue in our life, and I don't know much about it. I think it's likely it's happening, and I suspect it's likely that carbon-based fuels may play a role. One thing I'm very sure plays a role is the use of white technology by non-whites to destroy the world's canopy. And you can see this from satellites, that the trees are disappearing from all over the globe. We know that when you strip an area of the canopy, the temperature rises. That's true in America, just in a city. When the parking lots replace the trees, you have what they call the heat bubble. And when you're in Atlanta, where I've lived much of my life, you'll have a heat bubble. It'll be hotter in Atlanta than it will be 20 miles away where the trees still are. Atlanta is a city blessed with a great canopy, unlike a lot of cities. So these issues all go hand in hand with us. These so-called leftist issues, many of them are things that racial communitarians like me support anyway. But our views are based upon reality and theirs are not. And that's why their views will unavoidably lead to the kind of atrocities that you saw in Russia, like in the recent speech I gave to the American Renaissance. Their beliefs being in conflict with truth and reality must inevitably lead to catastrophic atrocities. Ours don't necessarily have to lead that way, but theirs necessarily must end up in something like the dekulakization in the Ukraine, or the Katyn Forest massacres of the Polish officer corps, or the Jim Jones suicide cult, which was all about equality. When you start saying that people are equal and they're not equal, you're at war with reality. And that ideology will unavoidably mutate into paranoia. Everybody's equal, but they're not really equal. So somebody must be causing the inequality. There must be white privilege. There must be the bourgeoisie must still somehow be present in the Soviet Union. They've got to be Trotskyite wreckers and monarchists wrecking the Soviet program. So inevitably, these ideologies that are not based on truth, which are at war with reality, they will inevitably end up in terrific atrocities.
This is exactly what I tell people. I say it's very logical. People say, why are there, 50 genders and this is insane? And I say it's because they're religiously egalitarian. And if you keep, you throw affirmative action and you keep throwing money at the problem, and man, it's still not equal. There's not enough women in STEM. And what's the deal? So they just keep inventing new kind of categories of excuses of why it's not equal and ways of discrimination. So I agree. And actually, I'm glad you mentioned Jim Jones and the Jonestown Massacre. Because I had always heard about this, but very vaguely. And I think you and I both know, and you'd brought this up in a very recent speech of yours about the double standard in the media. And it's obvious why they don't bring it up. It's because he was a devout Marxist who was trying to subvert and use religion kind of as an excuse. And a lot of people, the book you suggested, I started it. I only got to chapter 10. I'm in the middle of it.
It's a great book.
Yeah, so it's fantastic. And he's very fair, the author, about not putting himself in his shoes too much and saying like, okay, well, here's what we know. And based on the interviews, he's a very complicated guy. And it's tough to say how much of it was deceit and lying to himself, lying to others. But there's no doubt that he was a Marxist. And there's tons of recordings of this. This was his MO.
The saddest part about this tragedy is that good, decent people died who were well-intentioned.
The story begins in America during the 1970s when Jim Jones created a religious movement called People's Temple. The charismatic minister fought for civil rights and had a multiracial family.
It was the original Rainbow Family,
including his adopted son, Jim Jones Jr.
Did his message at the time resonate with you?
Yes, yes, yes. No isms, no sexism, racism.
But in the new book, The Road to Jonestown, author Jeff Gwynn details how Jones started to change.
He's convinced himself that he is some sort of superhuman martyr.
Jones persuaded nearly 1,000 followers to move to a remote jungle in Guyana.
The concept was to build a new world.
a socialist utopia.
Jonestown was described as this paradise, and it was not.
Former member Leslie Wagner Wilson says followers were overworked and underfed.
And then as time wore on, I realized that there was no future in Jonestown. Jim became increasingly paranoid.
Jones was obsessed with revolutionary suicide. He felt followers should be prepared to die for their cause, even having them drink fruit punch he claimed was poison.
Only after most of the people drank the liquid did he tell them, it's not poison, I was just testing you.
In November 1978, a concerned congressman, Leo Ryan, flew to Guyana to investigate, accompanied by NBC News. While some followers praised Jonestown, others wanted out.
He was explicit that he wanted people to die as a statement of equality. And he said, and these people were willing to die. They were like the Children's Crusade or something. You know, they were so committed to this mentally ill, crazy idea of equality that they were willing to die in a mass suicide as an egalitarian statement. He left the money. He had a lot of money. He had millions of dollars in that People's Temple. He left all that money to the Soviet Union. And when you get to the end of the book, there's a guy, I think his name was Carpenter. He and his wife and child were summoned to the pavilion to commit suicide like the rest of them. And he was pulled out of line. And Jones told him, no, I want you to take one of the suitcases of money and gold bullion. You need to get out of here and make sure it reaches the Soviet embassy. Because he was such an admirer of the Soviet Union. As the leading egalitarian country in the world. So yeah, it was all about equality. It was all about his war with reality. And as with Marxism, Jim Jones provided a philosophical, quasi-religious, Marxist way of organizing hatred and envy of superior people, where it appeared not to be just what it is, which is hatred and envy of people who are better, but had some kind of a philosophical format. And that's what Marxism does. You know, Marx, as I said in my talk to American Renaissance, is a nutcase. I mean, I had to read Marx and political philosophy in college. I couldn't believe anybody could actually fall for this goofy guy who claimed that he had figured out the iron laws of history, and he could describe all the stages of history that were to come before history reached a kind of secular paradise along the lines of the Book of Revelation, in which that everybody would be happy and so forth, and the state would wither away. And this guy's he's like a nutcase down at the bus station walking around with a sign saying Jesus is coming tomorrow. He's just a complete nut. But a guy from Eastern Europe that I met who lived under communism explained to me that the reason people believed it was they're born Marxists. They're born hating superior people, and Marxism provides a way to organize that hatred.
Yeah, amen. I've noticed that as well, and I think you can see that in the oversimplification of Marxism that how Marxism oversimplifies the world, and it's just there's the oppressor and there's the oppressed, and any inequality, it's because these people are taking advantage of it. And this is, again, one of my friends is a Marxist professor. And so we got in debates, and he was talking about how even the father in a family, that's unequal. And even though it's voluntary, right, and he's taking care of the women and the children, that's still, it's an oppressor thing, and it needs to be equal. And I was like, what world are you living in? It's a religious thing as well. I think every Marxist, they say, no, you don't understand it. And they kind of do the apologetics like the Bible, where things don't make sense. And they go, no. Well, what Marx really meant was, and they interpret it in their own bizarre way. But
they excuse every Marxist failure. There have been so many of these. Jonestown, Pol Pot in Cambodia, this guy running North Korea, Stalin and Lenin in Russia, and Mao in China, Castro in Cuba, the present people trying to run Venezuela. All of these things have failed. But like you say, when I was in college, I was part of a small minority of people. I've always been a part of a small minority of people. And I had all kinds of friends who were in SDS and stuff like that. And they would always explain, that wasn't real Marxism. That wasn't real Marxism. And it's just like you're saying, it's like the Christians say, oh, well, real Christianity has never been tried. Well, no, we've tried. It doesn't matter what some little intellectual sitting in a coffee house sipping his latte thinks. The garden variety of Marxism is what we have seen, and it's always failed, and it's always failed catastrophically, and it's always caused enormous human suffering.
Well, one of the things that you were saying earlier about how you don't like to pick left and right and just kind of be an ideologue and fit into the camps that our enemies and, other ideologues try to fit us into, I like this and I agree. And one of the things that I've tried to do to be introspective is I realized, and this is not my words, this is someone else pointing out this hypocrisy on the right, is that we do the same thing. Or I say, you know, take it with a grain of salt when I say we, that you've said many times you're not conservative, but you know, I used to be, there's a lot of us that were more libertarian, and there's the libertarian to alt-right pipeline, they say, and I think it's very logical to me, like in retrospect, why there's a pipeline, but most people it sounds counterintuitive. But anyways, we say, oh, that wasn't real capitalism, you know, that's crony capitalism, or if it was just this, and it sounds just like the Marxists. Because maybe it's inevitable. Maybe with free market capitalism, maybe it's inevitable that there's going to be a certain percentage of the population that tries to subvert the senators or tries to get monopolies. And I don't know any time that free market has ever worked 100% pure like the libertarians want it to. But of course, they'll say the same thing. They say, no, that's not real. And we need an anarcho-capitalist. And I say, and this is only in recent years I've realized this, is that maybe it's the same thing. That communism has never existed because it's utopia. Free market, true, you know, laissez-faire anarcho-capitalist is utopia.
If you go back to the U.S. Constitution, and when I say I'm not a libertarian, I don't want a slave state. And like I say, I believe in private property, and I certainly like freedom of speech. I like people to read what book I want to read, and that kind of thing. I'm not arguing for a really totalitarian dictatorship or something like that. But in the U.S. Constitution, it says that Congress shall determine weights and measures. You have to have somebody outside the market to say that there are 16 ounces in a larger unit of measurement. You know, there are so many pints in a quart and things like that. You can't have the butcher deciding that his pound is going to have 12 ounces. You know, you have to have somebody in society regulating and setting rules. They just have to happen. And you know, the crony capitalism, the owners of large plantations in Australia have been the most vociferous opponents of the White Australia policy. They wanted to be able to bring in coolies to have their produce harvested cheaply. The same in America with the guest workers coming in from Mexico to work on the farms and in the vineyards. You know, in a racial communitarian society, that wouldn't happen. You just have to pay your people more to have your own people pick your grapes. And that it's a much better society. You may not be free. You may not make as much money in the next quarter's statement of your profit. But in the long run, everybody will be better off, including you. Your children will live in a nation where they're safe, but they're not going to be killed like white people in South Africa or Christians in Syria. And you just have to curb these extreme examples of individual self-interest that are contrary to the interests of the group.
Right. So taking it back to the Jim Jones book, I like, and this is something I wanted your opinion on because it's another reason I wanted to get you on the podcast. Because you had said something, you talked about, and I forget where you said it, I'm sorry, but you had mentioned that in the 50s, when you were a young kid in school, it was just as leftist and Marxist and teaching this kind of hippy-dippy races get along kind of stuff, even back then. And I think this is something that we can fall into the trap of. There's a lot of the nostalgia, and people like to boomer bash, and they say, oh, it was the boomers did this and the boomers did that. And in this book, they talk about his mother, and this is the quote unquote, the greatest generation. And she was crazy and they got divorced and, you know, all this kind of weird stuff going on. And so I think you can play the blame game forever. You can say, oh, you know, the boomers are why millennials are so whiny and spoiled. And it's like, well, why are the boomers that way? You know, you could keep going back and back. And so, again, trying to find the balance and be introspective. But where do you draw the line? Because part of me says, yes, we are heading in a direction of degeneracy. And it does feel like our empire is collapsing. And there's if you look at other historical examples, you know, like the Weimar Republic or ancient Rome before it fell, it seems like there's these cycles. How do I know this is not confirmation bias? And also this whole nostalgia thing where I have rose-colored glasses for a generation I never even lived in. I only know it from TV shows. So, again, could you speak a little bit on, like, what do you think is BS when people look at the 50s, the good old days, and what is actually true? And do you personally see any of these trends? Do you think we are heading in a degenerate direction, or?
Well, I think we've degenerated tremendously. As I've gotten older, I've become sexually more and more puritanical. I was not always that way. I was always probably more straight-laced than most of the people, because I come out of a very religious background, and I've never really approved of casual sex and that kind of thing. But the it's a young lawyer I met here. I was on the other side of a case. I'll call him Jeremy. That's not his name. But we resolved the case very quickly. And he said, I want to talk to you. I scoped you out online. I've listened to you and stuff. And I've met him for lunch several times. And he said, I really want to get married and have kids. He's like 27 years old. I said, well, you should, a lot of good-looking women in Atlanta, and you're nice-looking, you've got a good job, you know how to behave, you're manly, you should have no trouble. He said, oh, it's very hard. He said, most women, I said, why is that? He said, most women of my age have had 40 or 50 sex partners. Now, I tell that to people, they say, oh, that can't be. But he explained it, that, the studies show the average kid starts having sex in eighth and ninth grade now. And, by the time some girl is 25, 10, 12 years have passed, and he's sizing her up as a wife potential, she's had 40 or 50 guys that she slept with. And he said, I just don't feel comfortable. I don't expect a virgin. But, we all like to think that we're the greatest lovers in the world and that kind of thing. But he said, I'm not sure I'm up to being number 51. I think this has just really been bad. I think it's especially bad for women. I don't believe in sexual equality. And I think promiscuity is psychologically much more damaging to women than it is to men. But we do have a degenerate age. And the 50s were there's an old English proverb. I like proverbs, as you probably know. But the proverb is, the child is father to the man. And the 50s were the father to the 60s and what we have today. It was all there. It was all coming. It's been coming for a long time. In a sense, it's been coming from the day that Thomas Jefferson wrote the Declaration of Independence and put that catastrophic phrase in, that all men are created equal, something that is just absolutely, totally contrary to truth in every sense. No matter how people try to explain it away, it's a terrible, destructive, horrible statement, and it set the country on a bad start. And it's been there engraved in the courthouse square and all that. And people are told that, they come to believe it, they come to act on it. And so it was always coming. The 50s were a terrible time. The 40s were a terrible time. The 30s were a terrible time. One of the things that liberals like to do, I use that, I guess I should stop calling them liberals since I say I'm not a liberal or conservative, but the system likes to subvert young people. Yeah, and you heard it when you were in high school. I heard it too, that, you're the most educated generation in history. And the meaning of that was, you shouldn't listen to your parents and grandparents. So you should be prideful and puff yourself up. It was a way to inoculate you against perhaps entertaining ideas other than what you were told in school. But they always say that, these ideas of equality and racial equality and mixing, they are new. This is a new cutting edge. They're not new. They're old and they're discredited. They failed. Eleanor Roosevelt's been rotting in her grave now for two generations, and she was all involved in it. So was Ruth Benedict and all the others of them. These are old ideas, and they permeated American society. Way back into, as a World War I, they were permeating American society. You had these posters in the Wilson era showing all of these people with different costumes and stuff, people of Slavic and German and English background, Americans all. And while we now believe that white Christian Americans are the founding stock and can be, regardless of whether they're Slavs or Teutons or Latins, part of our new society. This was just an expression of the Declaration of Independence, that these differences don't matter. And it grew from that through the 20s, where there was something of a reaction. You had Bothrop Stoddard and Madison Grant, the enactment of the National Origins Act, which brought immigration under control pretty much for a while, for about 30, 40 years. But by the 30s, with the Franklin Roosevelt coup, you know, the Marxists were in charge. 100,000 Americans went to the Soviet Union as volunteers in the late 20s and 30s to help build the utopian egalitarian society. Almost none of them lived. It's another great story of history that has been airbrushed out of the history books. But 100,000 Americans went to the Soviet Union, and almost all of them were killed by Stalin. And Roosevelt cooperated in thwarting their efforts to come home and in concealing their deaths. But anyway, there's a very interesting book on that called The Forsaken by a historian at Oxford University, the real Oxford in England. So he's a guy with real credentials and tells this story. There were so many of these lunatics that they overran a certain area of Moscow, and they actually had an English language newspaper for all of these fools. And eventually Stalin got them all and killed them off. But anyway, that's what the 30s were like. In the 40s, you had people like Eleanor and Franklin Roosevelt and Truman, who were totally committed to the race-fixing liberal program, and they were elected over and over again. And then to come to the 50s, I know Jared Taylor idolizes and idealizes the 50s, and people like to talk about the Eisenhower-era America. Eisenhower was an enemy of ours. Eisenhower was no friend of ours. Eisenhower sent the troops to Little Rock to level their bayonets at the bellies of Southern white kids and herd them into school with blacks. He did not send the bayonets to Budapest to stop the Soviets from crushing Hungary when Hungary broke free of the Warsaw Pact. Eisenhower's book, Crusade in Europe, that laid the foundation for him becoming president, was written by a guy who we have somewhat reason to believe was actually a Soviet spy, according to Whitaker Chambers, who ran one of the Soviet spy rings. You know, this was Eisenhower. You know, you go on to the Kennedys, and you know, it's always been there. I went to Druid Hills High School in Atlanta, which was the best public high school in the state. And there was a friend of mine I met who was there 8 years before I was. And he said that in 1954, they had a tableau vivant, a kind of a formal reading ceremony. And they got all the kids in this high school, all of them white, into an auditorium. And they had people in robes on the stage. And somebody would read out things out of a big program, and the other people in the robes on the stage would read out responses. And he said it started out with, who would look at a man and notice the color of his skin and say, I know who you are. And all of the kids in the robe read out the response, the sick in mind and soul. So this has been going on a long time. It was all there in the 50s. They just hadn't ratcheted it up to the level they've got it now. But we can't go back. The leftists are right when they call people on our side reactionaries. And we have a real problem with reactionaries. You will never go back to the 50s of America. And if you did, it would be just as bad, and it wouldn't last a tenth as long. The fact is, America is going to be majority non-white very, very soon. My prediction is it will be majority non-white in 10 years, not 2040 or 2050, like people are claiming. We have to give people a new vision, a vision of an ethnostate, something that is going to break free of America, learn the lessons of America, take what was good about America, scrap what was bad about America, and create a viable state for our people. That's what we have to do. There's no other choice. It's not a utopian idea. It's the only realistic program for our survival. Fiddling with elections and tinkering and trying to reform America, that is hopeless.
Hello, dear listener. This is DJ Whitepill from the future while editing the podcast. Just wanted to explain what's going on. So I always stop the conversations intermittently and break them into chunks because you never know when Skype or the internet is going to have some issues and not, you know, save the hours of conversation. And the other thing is because of my DIY ghetto setup, the microphone sometimes gives like a robot voice. And so after pausing it, and then the second time, starting again, then the robot voice started, and our guest interrupted and kind of said, hey, you know, I can't hear you, hold on. And the third time when I started the conversation again, I was hyperbolic and self-deprecating, in which case he stopped me and explained that this was a bad habit. And the conversation we had was pretty interesting, and I thought it was worth keeping in the podcast. So check it out.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry about that. This is why I'm paranoid, and I stopped recording. It's my ghetto.
You're not paranoid. Stop putting yourself down. Your subconscious. No, I'm serious. Your subconscious is listening when you make self-derogatory statements like that.
Well, okay. One of the things that I think is very charming about your associate Jared Taylor, Uncle Jared, is I think. Well, yeah, let's put this in the podcast. I'm curious about this. Because I don't know, it's really hard to tell what percentage of my psychology is just truly inherently a white person thing. You know, people say the pathologically altruistic, and what part of it is propaganda from Marxist and I don't know, let's be honest, Jewish intellectuals who have an immigrant complex and who control the media, right? So it's hard to debate that. If same thing with, like, I find other races sexually attractive. I think that's natural. I think most people do. But it's like, okay, what percentage, like how much of that is this constant beating over the head in every commercial you see? And again, the pathologically altruistic, sure, there's an argument to be made that we evolved in these snowy places and we needed to trust the outsider because there's only a few people in a cave and we needed to hunt mammoths versus, you know what I mean? All these different kind of arguments. And same thing, I personally, I like the self-deprecating kind of thing. And I think it's a white person thing. Maybe it's neurotic Jews because I grew up watching Seinfeld and I think that, but that's one of the things Jared, he's just, you know, he's almost insanely humble. And I think it's a charming white person thing, but it's also, I don't know. Yeah. Is this kind of from growing up in an anti-white society? Cause I'll be frank with you. Of course, I'm very confident and arrogant and, you know, ask my girlfriend, I'm very like, oh, I'm going to change the world and I'm, you know, I've got it, but I agree. It affects your subconscious, but yeah. What would you say? What do you think? That's an inherently white thing, or do you think it's gone too far? Do you think, you know, our generation is brainwashed?
Well, I think Christianity has played a big role in promoting self-deprecation, and I think that's really not very good. You know, I come out of a hyper-Calvinistic background, and a very unusual childhood. I don't think there was one American in 100 that came out of a family like mine. But, you know, the Calvinists have a very negative view of human nature. And that was the first thing that caused me to start questioning what I'd been told, was the idea that people were just all rotten and evil. And I would look at people like Leonidas and the Spartans, and I think, I'd rather admire these people. I'm willing to die for their city-state. You know, they seem like nice people to me. I really like these guys. But, you know, The Episcopalians wanted to change their prayer book and their religious services several years back because they have a prayer of contrition that refers to themselves as miserable offenders, and they felt this was too negative. The prayer we prayed at Emory Parish, where I spent much of my childhood in Atlanta, our prayer of contrition began like, "Oh Lord, I acknowledge I am a wretch, utterly depraved, unprofitable to any good. I'm not all the way over with all the self-esteem people, but I don't think that's a healthy attitude. If I had kids, I would not expose them to that kind of negativity." And Jews, on the other hand, have every Jew is a genius. As a Hungarian friend of mine once said, the Jews are the world's biggest mutual admiration society. And they're taught to promote themselves. And it's no wonder that they're successful in our society when you have all these Christians who have been taught to be, you know, self-deprecatory and humble and all this. And then you have people who are saying, I'm the greatest. I ought to be president of this club. I ought to do this because I'm the greatest. You know, no wonder we lose in competing as people like that. I think that I'm opposed to false humility and I'm opposed to arrogance. I think you should simply be what you are. And You know, I'm not arrogant, I hope, but most of my life I was terribly humble. I got so much negativity as a child from the church and my parents that when people would come up to me and say it, flatter me, it's just like, you did a great job with that case. I was extremely uncomfortable. I was physically uncomfortable. I didn't know how to react to praise. And it didn't matter that I had done a great job. I would start saying, oh, gee, shucks, no, I was just lucky. And Jared, to some extent, is that way. Jared and I were talking one time about the Olympic Games, and he said he disliked it very much when the athletes jumped around on the stage and pumped their arms. And I told him, no, if you're the biggest pole vault jumper in the world, I don't begrudge you jumping around in ecstasy and joy at your victory when you're getting your gold medal. You know, I think that false humility is as bad, if not maybe worse, than false pride.
Yeah, no, I agree. To be honest, I know I take it with a grain of salt, and I'm very hyperbolic in my speech, but I agree with you that your subconscious is listening, and I actually think, I'm a believer in affirmations, and a lot of successful people I look up to are big proponents of affirmations, so... Yeah, I agree. I should probably watch it. I'm awesome. I'm great.
not like that. But you know, you like yourself. You know, you like yourself, and you know, right. I'm going to handle things. I'm going to do them well.
Right.
I may make mistakes, but if I make mistakes, I will rectify the mistakes. I'll learn from the mistakes, and I'll go on. But the hyper negativity is a really bad thing, and it affects little children. And I don't think it affects them much now because the current generation has not been raised in that. When I was reared, they've been reared with the other extreme, that everything they do is great. And I can tell you from having employed and dealt with a lot of people of your generation, there's a real generational shift there. I don't believe in blaming generations, boomers or young people or the grandparents or parents of boomers. But it's difficult with young people. If you start telling them something they've done wrong, they get very upset because they've never heard anyone critiquing their work. It's difficult. We've gone to the other extreme.
Yeah, no, I agree. I don't have that as much. I definitely have it in my generation, but I grew up with four brothers, so they're constantly beating me and telling me I suck. So I think I got a thicker skin in that sense.
Yeah,
so
I had two of them.
Yeah, I'm sure they had their impact. So I wanted to do a quick thing. So another thing I like to mix in, because like I told you, I try to do a little bit of an NPR vibe. And part of that is mixing in music. And so I creeped your Twitter, your basically defunct Twitter. Doesn't seem like you use it, but I saw a song, Hunters of Kentucky. So I wanted to mix that in because I think it's a lovely song and to kind of do a nice little musical break. Do you mind kind of giving your thoughts on it? Or like, why do you like that song in particular?
I like it because it's quintessentially WASP, which is one reason I think that it has been deleted. It's a very Anglo-Saxon song. It was Andrew Jackson's campaign song for the presidency. And the song is about the Battle of New Orleans, which is, I don't revel in a battle like that. I don't like the idea of American Englishmen killing other Englishmen. We shouldn't have had these brother wars. We certainly don't need them now. We don't need to go to war with Russia the way a lot of people want us to. But anyway, I think it's a charming song, and it's a funny song. If you get to the last stanza, if it's the version that I'm familiar with, it turns it around that the hunters from Kentucky are going to be the guardians. They're going to take care of and protect the ladies of New Orleans. It's a very funny song, as well as a heroic song. It's about volunteers who volunteered to go fight and take the Louisiana Purchase and keep it... for us. So I like the song.
Ye gentlemen and ladies fair who grace this famous city, just listen if you've time to spare while I rehearse a ditty. And for the opportunity, conceive yourselves quite lucky, for 'tis not often that you see a hunter from Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. We are a hardy freeborn race, each man to fear a stranger. Whate'er the game, we join in chase, despising time and danger. And if a daring foe annoys, whate'er his strength and forces, we'll show him that Kentucky boys are alligator horses. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. I suppose you've read it in the prints how Pakenham attempted to make old Hickory Jackson wince, but soon his scheme repented. For we with rifles ready cocked thought such occasion lucky, and soon around the general flock the hunters of Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. You've heard, I suppose, how New Orleans is famed for wealth and beauty. There's girls of every hue, it seems, from snowy white to sooty. So Pakenham, he made his brags, if he in fight was lucky, he'd have their girls and cotton bags in spite of old Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. But Jackson, he was wide awake and was not scared at trifles, for well he knew what aim we take with our Kentucky rifles. So he led us down to Cypress Swamp, the ground was low and mucky. There stood John Bull in martial pomp, and here was old Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. A bank was raised to hide our breast, not that we thought of dying, but that we always like to rest unless the game is flying. Behind it stood our little force, none wished it to be greater, for every man was half a horse and half an alligator. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. They did not let our patience tire before they showed their faces. We did not choose to waste our fire, so snugly kept our places. But when so near we saw them wink, we thought it time to stop them. And 'twould have done you good, I think, to see Kentuckians drop them. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. They found at last 'twas vain to fight where lead was all the booty, and so they wisely took to flight and left us to our beauty. And now if danger e'er annoys, remember what our trade is. Just send for us, Kentucky boys, and we'll protect you, ladies. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky. Oh, Kentucky, the hunters of Kentucky.
It's completely forgotten. There's a similar one that's forgotten in the American Revolution called Chester. Somehow you should look up Chester and listen to that. I've only heard Chester played at a 4th of July or other so-called patriotic gathering one time in my life, because it's too waspy.
Thank you.
So speaking of waspy songs you like, or just any song you like, do you mind giving a few other, again, to inspire people in our movement who just get so sick of reading the news and everything's getting, you know, like the Browning of America and all the just negative stuff, going to war with Iran, potentially, just all this crazy stuff, who need a break, they just want to relax and listen to something good. Do you have any other songs you like or anything that you maybe you perceive as is historically worthwhile or quote-unquote red-pilled lyrics, something that you think maybe that is anti-egalitarian, something that touches your belief system?
Well, I have lots of songs. I love music. I can't read it, but I grew up memorizing hymns and patriotic songs and English and Scottish songs and some German songs. So there are lots of them. I could keep you on for a long time, but tracing it back to England, I like "The King Shall Have His Own Again," even though my ancestors were all fighting for the Parliament against the King in the British Civil War.
Let rogues and cheats prognosticate concerning kings or kingdoms' fate. I think myself to be as wise as he that gazeth on the skies. My sight goes beyond the depth of a pond or rivers in the greatest rain, whereby I can tell that all will be well when the king enjoys his own again. Yes, this I can tell, that all will be well when the king enjoys his own again. There's neither swallow, nor dove, or date can soar more high or deep or wait, nor show a reason from the stars what causeth peace or civil wars. The man in the moon may wear out his shirt by running after Charles's wain, but all's to no end, for the times were not meant till the king enjoys his own again. Yes, this I can tell, that all will be well when the king enjoys his own again. For 40 years this royal crown hath been his father's and his own, and is there any one but he that in the same should share a me? For who better may the sceptre sway than he that hath such right to reign? Then let's hope for peace, for the wars will not cease till the king enjoys his own again. Yes, this I can tell, that all will be well when the king enjoys his own again. Though for a time we see Whitehall with cobwebs hanging on, instead of gold and silver braid which formerly was wont to have, with rich perfume in every room, delightful to that princely train. Yet the old again shall be when the time you see that the king enjoys his own again. Yes, this I can tell, that all will be well when the king enjoys his own again. Then fears avaunt upon the hill, my hope shall cast her anchor still, until I see some peaceful dove bring home the branch I dearly love. Then will I wait till the waters abate which now disturb my troubled brain, then forever rejoice when I've heard the voice that the king enjoys his own again. Yes, this I can tell, that all will be well when the king enjoys his own again.
I like Blue Britannia.
Thank you.
In America, I like the Appalachian ballad, Wildwood Flower, which is one of either the oldest or one of the oldest ballads in America. Like the revolutionary hymn, Chester, like I mentioned, let tyrants shake their iron rod and slavery clang her galling chain. I like Chester. I like Columbia, the gem of the ocean. Thank you.
I don't want to keep you too long. I have a bunch of questions still, so let me know. I want to be respectful of your time. Don't hesitate to kind of interrupt and say, hey, I'm going to go get dinner.
Hey, but, it's after work hours here, so I have no work to do, and I also am struggling to lose my pot belly, so I don't need to go eat.
Right on. No, I actually did a fast, I suggest. I don't know if you've heard it. It's kind of a fad, but you know, you like going with human nature and the reality and the truth of biology, yada, yada. Intermittent fasting.
I tried that just a couple of days ago, and I think it works. I'll try it. One day fast. I think that would be a good idea.
Yeah, I highly suggest it. I did it for a bit, and I'm gonna do it again. And I think it's good. Once your body kicks into ketosis, you don't feel as hungry. Mm-hmm. When you still have insulin spikes, you know, I get very cranky. My girlfriend knows to have food ready as soon as I come home because I have like a 2-hour traffic ride. I'm really irritable, and she just lets me eat, and then we talk and hey, how's your day? But when I was doing the fasting, it actually didn't, I was totally, it's like almost like Zen because it's getting the energy from your fat and it's like a flat energy instead of these, you know, sugar spikes and stuff. Anyways, so back to the political stuff. I wanted to ask you, I had heard in other interviews that you've been basically racially aware for a long time. You're a good old Southern boy, you know, so maybe it's just your upbringing that they didn't have the same kind of propaganda. I think you've been an activist more or less since you were like 15 or 16. Even so, though, I know for most people, red pilling is a gradual process, you know, just experiences they've had, research. Having, you know, taking all that into consideration, is there any specific cataclysmic events that you think, wow, that was a good red pilling experience that kind of woke you up to make you racially aware or never mind racially aware, just aware in the sense that you are now, your belief system now?
I think we always can cite instances that there are probably three or four of them that helped shape me. One was that my father's making explicit the implicit message of advertising, which I spoke about at Amlin, and he would point out to us the subliminal messages of advertising, that if you use some hair tonic, all the good-looking girls would come kiss you at high school, and how ludicrous that idea is in promoting Brill cream. But I remember 1956 with the Hungarian Revolution. It did occur to me, and I heard old people saying that it was interesting that Eisenhower would not give the Hungarians any help. He would not send bayonets to Hungary, but he would send them to Little Rock. And it was obvious even then, when I was only 9 years old, it was obvious that the U.S. was betraying the Hungarians and was not helping them. That behind all of the pretended anti-communism, there was a failure to act. And that was just sort of a vague feeling. The thing that really specifically hit me more than anything else was about 1963. My oldest brother and I, he took me to a meeting at Emory University. It was a Goldwater meeting. And somebody spoke. I can't remember who spoke. It was a boring speaker. It may have been Russell Kirk. I was not interested in the speech. But after it was over, I went back to the literature tables, and they had books for sale. And I went over to the, and even then, conservatives tended to be older people. So I was like, what would I have been? I was 16. So I was like the youngest guy in the whole room. And so the guy running the book display chatted me up and said, "Well, young fellow, what tell me about yourself," or whatever. I told him I was a student at Druid Hills High School, and we chatted. And somehow the conversation moved to McCarthy. And I was racially aware instinctively, but I was not aware of McCarthy. And so when he started talking about McCarthy came up, I said, "Well, you know, he was a bad guy." And this guy said, "Well, tell me why that is." And I said, "Well, you know, he accused patriotic people of being communists and subversives and things like that." And so this guy was rather rude. He had not read Dale Carnegie's How to Make Friends and Influence People. Most people would have just been furious. But he said, well, where did you learn that, kid?" And I said, "Well, you know, in history class in high school." He said, "Well, you ever read anything about McCarthy?" And he said, other than what you were told in your history book?" And I had to admit, no, I hadn't. And he said, "Well, you obviously think you're intelligent and you think you're some kind of intellectual, and maybe you are. But you didn't make your mind up on this issue by reading both sides. You've just been fed propaganda from the government, and you've made your mind up by listening to one side." And I thought about it, and I said, "Well, I have to admit, that's true." I said, "I've never read any books." He said, I don't know there are books." He said, "Oh, there are books." And he said, "I can give you a list of them. I can give you three or four titles. Would you read them if I gave them to you?" And I said, "Yeah, I'd do that." So he gave me several books on McCarthy, Witnessed by Whitaker Chambers. And I went to the Decatur DeKalb Library, and amazingly, they had those books. And I was shocked. I had no idea that there had been so many Soviet spies, so many spy rings, such pro-communist activity by Franklin Delano Roosevelt. But anyway, I realized that we were being lied to, and that the history we were being taught in the high school, the standard government textbooks, was lying about the McCarthy era, and probably they were lying about everything else. I already knew they were lying about the Civil War. I got into trouble with one of my teachers who depicted Lincoln as some kind of saint, you know, just living in a life of agony in the White House as he oozed love for Southerners and such a great Christian man. And I pointed out that we were sitting in a city that had been burned to the ground by Lincoln, a crime for which we hanged Germans. And she became irate that I would say that about great Lincoln. But anyway, it was things like that that had a big... I started reading. When I read the stuff about McCarthy, I thought, I've got to educate myself about all kinds of issues. I've tried to find books that will give me the other side to what we're being taught in school. And I learned what we were taught in American history, and that kind of class in high school and in college. Most of it was untrue.
So speaking of communism, you had said in a debate, you were talking about how communism was actually an American export.
Likewise with the Cold War, it flatters Americans to think that we overthrew communism. We did not overthrow communism. Communism was created in America and exported to Russia. As my Russian tutor said, it was not a Russian civil war, it was a war of alien conquest. And the United States had a policy of sustaining communism, which was disguised throughout the Cold War. But the U.S. was never a threat to communism. Communism was overthrown by the Russian people from within. It was the Russian people who gathered 500,000 of them around the mayor's office in St. Petersburg and 500,000 around the Duma in Moscow and faced tanks with bare hands, even as National Public Radio was sneering that there are only 500,000. As if you get 50 Americans to do something like that. I don't think that either of these can be cited as an example of an achievement by universal suffrage democracy. The Cold War, I have come to see as a huge hoax and deception perpetrated upon the American people to justify the oppressive system state. The idea that we were threatened by a nation with a gross national product less than that of the Netherlands, which we were never allowed to know until after the Soviet Union imploded, that notion is silly.
And that didn't make sense to me. I was trying to Google. I've heard this a couple times, that actually a lot of the Bolsheviks were from New York, but every time I've searched, I can't find anything, especially nothing from credible sources. So can you elaborate on American export?
Yeah, I'm told from what I have read that the majority of the members of the Supreme Soviet in St. Petersburg at the time of the Russian Revolution were living in New York City when the Tsar abdicated. And there's certainly a lot of them were. Trotsky was working as a tailor in New York City. And they were put on a boat, and the whole pack of them were shipped off to Russia, which was surprising because the U.S. entered the war about the time of the February Revolution, the abdication of the Tsar in early 1917. It was known that the Bolsheviks were getting money from the Germans and that they were committed to taking Russia out of the war. So, you know, Wilson was jailing people right and left for opposing the war, but these people were put on a boat. And they were shepherded across the ocean. They stopped at Halifax. The guy who was the military head of the British setup in Halifax interned them and said, these people are enemies of the Allies. We're going to keep them here. And mysteriously, orders came from the government of Lloyd George that you will not keep them. You will let them go. And this guy actually wrote a book about it. I have it somewhere in my library, a little book about his experience with this, and so the communists were loaded back on the boat and resumed their route to Russia, and they entered Russia from, I think it was Murmansk, and went down to St. Petersburg, while Lenin and the others were coming from Switzerland in the famous sealed train. But it was in America that the financial support for them lay and the ethnic support for them lay. And we exported these people to Russia.
Right. That's what I was thinking, is because Jacob Schiff funded it. So I figured that's what you're talking about.
Jacob Schiff was the Soros of his time. And he funded the Soviet Revolution. He was a banker. Here again, these are the real practical things about which show how phony the socialist Marxist movement is. They always get funding from big business and big banks. And protection from the very establishment that they claim they're overthrowing, because most of it's just a con game. It's phony as hell, and communism was phony as hell.
So speaking of communism, and I guess the Eastern Bloc, one of the other reasons, one of the big ones I wanted to get you on the podcast, is you're a self-described Slavophile, and for most listeners, they know that I live in Moscow, and so I like Russians as well. But I wanted to ask some kind of uncomfortable things, because I think those of us in our, I guess, quote-unquote movement, or in the subculture, we never shy away from the uncomfortable truths. We go down the rabbit hole. We stare at the abyss. So let's talk about some uncomfortable stuff. A lot of people, once you become racially aware, they get a little, they purity spiral, right? And they say, that's not white. And I think they actually have a good point, that if you look at, in the UK, Irish were slaves, and there was one of the earliest racism was against Irish being depicted as monkeys and stuff.
Stop. That's largely fabricated. It's fabricated by Irish propaganda groups, which are the equivalent for the Irish of La Raza for the Hispanics, or the NAACP for the blacks, or the B'nai B'rith for the Jews. There've been efforts. You hear about the NINA signs, no Irish need apply. Senator Leahy of Vermont used to like to talk about how he was Irish and he could understand black people and immigrants because his ancestors had lived in Boston and they had up signs, no Irish need apply. There was a woman who tried to do a dissertation on this, and she went back and went through all of these newspapers and magazines and stuff all over the country where there was large Irish. So she found exactly one no Irish need apply. It's greatly exaggerated. The prejudice against the Irish is enormously exaggerated.
Huh. I had no idea. I will ask you later in an email if you can send me some links or books that kind of elaborate on this and prove that this is exaggerated and this is BS, because that's interesting. I've never heard that. I knew that a lot of this, like the Chinese immigrant wave and the Italian, a lot of people who are, you know, open borders advocates always bring it up. And I heard that in school. My AP American history teacher said, hey, this anti-Mexican sentiment is, you know, history has shown that they always do it. They didn't like the Italians. But if we look at the trends of immigration, it's never been as insane as it is now, just percentage wise. So I knew it was exaggerated, but I'm not going to lie. I guess I fell for the propaganda.
They have every interest to overstate this. Nobody has an interest in understating it. And there are people who have a lot of interest in overstating it. And they promote this to promote division among white people. And I'm as guilty as the Irish. You know, I grew up in a family that didn't like the Irish. And I, as a child, was very prejudiced against the Irish. I remember when I first met Irish people, I actually met a bunch of Irish people at a YAF, a Young Americans for Freedom convention. And I was astonished that there were Irish Catholics at a conservative meeting. I thought they were all communists. I thought the Irish were communists. But I revised my opinion, and I now see how harmful all of this nationalism and these ethnic quarrels are. And they use this stuff amazingly with white Americans, you know, that oh, your ancestors were Irish, and they were discriminated. Your ancestors were Italian, they were discriminated against. You know, this has nothing to do, first of all, it's exaggerated. They ought to be grateful that they were allowed in to begin with. And secondly, they have everything in common, virtually, with the founding stock of the country. And they ought to be nothing in common with the Chinese and Muslims that are coming in. What their ancestors experienced in Boston in the 1840s after the Irish potato famine, you know, this is not an event that is usefully instructive of what a white Roman Catholic Irish guy in America today needs to be thinking about. I have distant cousins from Northern Ireland who came and visited us when we got married. And to my amazement, they began lecturing us about how we treated black people. And I replied, I was just a kid, I replied, you know, you people hate the Irish. Why are you surprised that we don't like the blacks? And they began talking about all their problems with the Irish. And I told them, even then, when I was a teenager, I said, if I could get 10,000 people from Ulster, 5,000 of us Presbyterian Scots-Irish, and 5,000 of the Roman Catholic Irish, and put them in a big bottle and shake them up and pour half of them out in South Atlanta around the housing project filled with black Protestants, and the other half out in Tijuana, surrounded by Roman Catholic Mexicans, you would be astonished to find that your interest and everything about you is about a 98% shared interest with each other, and how little you have in common with black Protestants or Mexican Roman Catholics. But they use these things to divide white people, which is going to bring us to the subject that I hope we're going to reach on, is who will qualify to be a suitable citizen, a suitable co-national, a suitable racial brother in our idealistic utopian ethno-state? Who will qualify? That's a really big question we have to answer.
I agree, and there's three things that I want to touch on that you'd mentioned. One was nationalism. The other that I was trying to get at is about Slavic peoples. But before we get there, because you had brought up the Scots-Irish, I looked at Appalachia, and they are uniquely affected by the opioid epidemic. And I wanted your two cents on it, because it seems like you have more of a connection there. You can see through the propaganda and the BS, but I don't think this is propaganda. I was looking at just statistics of, you know, overdoses, and we all know that there's crack is seen as more of a black drug, meth is more of a white drug. They overlap, but yeah, opiates specifically, over the counter, the big pharma, that is a uniquely white problem, and it's the worst in Appalachia. Is it just the poverty in Appalachia? I know the Scots-Irish are very kind of warrior people. My mom loves the show, I think it's called Highlander or Outlander, but it's about the Scots-Irish. You know, we all know like Braveheart and stuff like that. So I was curious, do you have any philosophy or opinion on why that uniquely affects them?
I had never thought about it. You brought up the idea that that certain drugs affect certain communities differently. With the Scotch-Irish, as with the Irish and as with the Scots, and if all of you Irish Catholics out there, they're mixing up your bombs to go blow up the Irish Protestant, just stop for a moment, because I'm not beating up on you. I'm talking about all of us as a group. The Irish, the Scots, the Swedes, and the Russians, we all know that these people have a real weakness for alcohol, far more so than the French or the Italians, and certainly far more than Jews. Jews have the lowest incidence of alcoholism, whereas Celts in places like Ireland and Scotland and Slavs have the highest rate of alcoholism. And Indians, of course, American Indians have the highest of all of them. So I think that there's a real weakness among Northern Europeans for these kind of, you know, drinking and drugs and stuff like that. And the Scotch-Irish probably have, they're not really Celtic, they're a mixture of Celt and Anglo. But they've certainly, I know in my own family, we've got genes for alcoholism on both sides of the family, and I've had relatives who are alcoholics, and I'm familiar with it.
Yeah, it gets the best of us. I think it's a pro and a con. It's our greatest strength, I think, because I definitely have an addictive personality, and I think it can be used to your advantage, that you can use it to create great things and get obsessive and take the risks. You know, it's almost cliche at this point, but to bring it back, the Faustian spirit, right? That makes the white people expand and explore, whereas the Asians don't have that. So there's something to be said about that kind of addictive, the excitement. You know, we're adrenaline junkies, and alcohol is a substitute for that, because we live in this modern era where we just play video games and have porn and whatever. But really, our ancestors were meant to go into battle and kind of take over. So I always try to accept and just be introspective, look in the mirror and say, okay, I take who I am and my people and my ancestors, my culture, for good, for, you know, almost like a marriage, for better or for worse, in sickness and health. So to take it back to the Slav thing, they say, so okay, never mind the propaganda about the anti-immigrant, the stuff I've heard, just looking at Hitler, neighbors always hate each other, right? We see this everywhere, you know, Koreans and Japanese. So that's a big thing with Hitler. And I'm not some fanatic of Hitler, so let's not go down that road. But I'm just saying that we have seen people who are racially aware, who are proud of their race and want what's best for them. They tend to purity spiral. And what I tell my girlfriend and the taxi driver that I'm good friends with, the Russians, I say, hey, all the racists and even neo-Nazis, they love Putin and almost buy the propaganda where they're like, yeah, he's the savior of the white race. Like modern racists, even the neo-Nazis, really like Russians. So that I'm not trying to divide. I consider them white, but still, you go on certain forums, you start to go down the rabbit hole, and there is a debate to be had. They do have Asiatic blood. And my personal theory living here, and I'd love to hear your two cents and just belief in general. I want to make it clear, they are our brothers, or if nothing else, at least our cousins, and we need to be comrades with them. I'm not trying to divide, but we have to, you know, let's address the question. So my theory is that I think it's like Brazil or India or any kind of multicultural society, that there's always a caste system, and it's harder to notice. And there's a little bit of a caste system that you even see in a homogenous country like Japan, and it's the Yayoi and the Jomon, and it's within the subspecies of Japanese. There's other genetic clusters. This always happens. And so to bring it to a bigger, more philosophical question that's usually asked by our enemies in bad faith, they say, well, what is white? It's arbitrary. And how do you define white? And white is a new concept. And to be fair, this is a genuine, worthwhile question to be had. I want to ask this in good faith, that, okay, where do we draw the line? And to be honest, looking at history, it is kind of arbitrary. We do, white clearly exists. Indo-Europeans, we can identify it genetically. So I'm not saying there's no such thing as white, but things do get blurry. We look at Finns, they have Asiatic blood. And so to take it back to my theory, I think Russia does have a caste system. I think part of the reason that there's this insane income inequality, and maybe it's confirmation bias, and I'm in too many alt-right forums, and I'm just, you know, it's bullshit, pardon my French. But it does seem to, you see it in their faces. The lower caste, it's not a black and white pigment, you know, pigmentocracy that you'd see that's easier to notice in India or in Brazil. Brazil, in South America, where they mix, you go, oh, there's more African blood, you know, in Haiti, they're at the lower. It's not as clear, but it seems like the more Nordic blood is in the top upper castes. And I teach rich kids, and it's mainly Jews, and it's mainly Nordic people. And when you look at people who are, you know, like the janitors and the, you know, the lower caste, it seems like they have more of that kind of Mongol Eastern blood. And it is a very diverse country, to be honest. It's huge. They've totally expanded. It's no longer Kiev Rus. They've expanded and they've taken over the Bashkir Turks and ever, you know, there is a lot of diversity. So I guess my question for you is, where do you draw the line? Are they considered white? Do you think there's any truth to that, where people kind of discriminate against Slavs? And I guess the last thing I'll say is, one thing that I looked at is the Romanovs. I guess when they were killed, the very last of the Romanovs, I guess they started to mix with the West, and they were no longer Slavic at all. They were mainly Western European, or not, I don't want to say Western European, but more Western and Nordic. So can you just speak on that? And you, because you're a Slavophile, your history is much, much better than mine. And so educate the audience, educate me, and tell me your thoughts.
Well, I suggested that we talk about who would qualify for citizenship in our ideal ethnostate. And I worked out a personal answer to that. That is that anybody will be acceptable as a citizen of the new white commonwealth and of the ethnostate that we hope to build in North America, who all of whose ancestors were duophysitical Christians as of 1492. A duophysitical Christian is a Christian who believes in the traditional Christian theology of the Nicene Creed, that Christ had two personalities, which has nothing to do with both human and divine, as opposed to Monophysites, who believe that he was either only human or only divine. That the theological aspect of it is a convenient way, a litmus test of getting people who are by and large racially okay and who entirely share the same basic culture of white Europeans. It would leave out people like the Egyptian Copts and the Ethiopians, who were Christians as of 1492 because they were Monophysites. It would leave out Mexican Indians and Incas in Peru because they weren't already duophysitical Christians as of 1492. It would include the Latins, it would include the Celts, it would include the Germans, and it would include the Slavs. So it would be a broad enough area where you could have a viable section of the globe to sustain a healthy, happy, prosperous, strong community. In America, basically all those people are acceptable. The Irish, the Italians, the Anglo-Saxons, the French Huguenots, you know, everybody would qualify. And race alone is not enough to define a state. You can go to, there was a famous picture of a woman in Afghanistan that appeared in National Geographic, this beautiful Aryan woman. But you could not build a common society with a Muslim woman, regardless of how much she shared your physical DNA. The same thing in the Balkans. I saw a picture of the Muslim militia in Bosnia-Herzegovina, and they were really splendid Aryan guys. And friends of mine who are from that area of the world explained that they tend to be blonder and blue-eyeder and taller than the Christians, because they were the people who converted to Islam and their women were off limits to the Turks as the occupying power. So they're whiter than the Croatians and Serbs. But I could go as a Scots-Irish, Scottish, French Huguenot, Presbyterian. If I had to, I could go to Sicily. And I could live in Sicily with a bunch of Sicilian dark Roman Catholics, provided that I behaved myself and didn't really make an ass of myself and get up their nostrils. I could go to bed at night and be safe. They're not going to come for me. I could not do that with all these blonde-haired, blue-eyed Muslims in Bosnia-Herzegovina. No matter how much they look like our racial ideal, they are culturally different from us. So you have to have both a historical and cultural community and a racial community. And I think my test would allow for this. Having said that, I have to give you an admonition. and that is you've used the term several times, lower class, to describe working people. Working people are not lower class. They may be working class, but they're not lower class. The eye and the brain do not hate the hand and the foot. And all levels of society are going to be part of our community. I've mentioned this before. If you've watched my things online, you probably heard the story. But one of my most vivid memories of childhood was when my father became enraged at me. I'd gotten in a fight in school and taken a note home to my father, who was a very severe parent. And I was trying to decide what to say. And so when I took the note in and he read it, he asked me to tell him about the fight. And I started out by telling him how bad the other kid was. And I said, well, Nicky's just a jerk. His father's a ditch digger. And I didn't get further than that before my father's fingers grasped the lapels of my coat and he jerked me off the floor and said, if I ever hear or see you acting like a little snot again toward working people, it will be a day you will long remember. He said, I do not care about the fight anywhere near as much as I care your sneering at somebody whose father does manual labor. We would not have running water without people like Nicky's father. And I've never forgotten that. And that has to be our attitude toward working people.
Well, actually, what I tell people here in Russia, I say, you know, I'm an Amerikansky gopnik. And the gopniks are like the lower class people. So actually, I grew up lower middle class. That's part of why, I mean, that's part of my beliefs of the podcast, is that the same thing. Quick little anecdote. There was a British guy I was friends with on Facebook that I met in Japan, and it was after Brexit, and he was sneering at the lower class, and he said, it's funny, and he posted a map, and it showed the map of all the people who voted to leave the EU, and he was like, oh, these are all places that are pieces of he said crap or shit, whatever, that no one would want to go to. And I told him, I said, maybe it's because you're a posh da-da-da-da, you know, SOB, I used foul language. Yeah. And I said, it's funny that Rotherham voted to leave. Isn't that a coincidence? And I said, you don't actually see it. It's that, you know. So for me, I grew up, I got jumped by Mexicans because I taught with little Mexican kids and I lived in the ghetto. And, you know, I'm friends with Mexicans. I have no problem. But that's my whole theory. And that's why I ask everyone, what is your experience that kind of red-pilled you? And usually it's people who are well-traveled. Or they can be lower class, so they have no choice to live in a gated community. So yeah, I have no ill will. I wear it as a badge of honor.
I know you don't. But we have to be very careful. We're not like the Buckley conservatives. One of the things I noticed, a lot of things I didn't like about conservatives when I joined Young Americans for Freedom as a teenager in high school. I remember going to a meeting and they had little buttons these asses were wearing saying, soak the poor and stuff like this, and that they were all trying to act like they were upper class, like Buckley. Buckley was very affected and had this affected English accent and all this stuff. You know, this really grated on my nerves. All of these little middle class social climbers trying to pretend that they were upper class and sneering at lower class people. But you're not like that. I know you're not like that. And it's just a little point to remember that we are communitarians and that everybody in society who contributes is entitled to respect and honor. And that will be our kind of ethnic state. We were not going to have this kind of snotty English class system. And yeah, the working class people all over America, all over the world, they're the best people. If we could restrict the vote, the franchise, the voting to intelligent working class people, we would have great countries. I've talked to my brick masons, my electricians, my plumbers. They all get it. They all understand it. And most of them have intact families, and they feel a loyal connection to other people and to their country. It's when you get in the upper classes that the further up the scale you go, the greater the rot.
Yeah, I agree. But I think it goes both ways, that we also shouldn't just automatically judge all the upper class people and say, oh, you know, you bourgeois this and that, because it goes into the Marxism, and it reminds me of the Jonestown thing. There's a great painting I saw. It was the Champagne Socialist, the archetype. So it's a cartoon, and it's a woman who's sitting on top, like literally sitting on top of a bunch of migrants, and they're all, you know, washing, painting her nails and giving her marijuana and porn, and it shows, and on the Champagne Socialist woman's shirt is Che Guevara. And it's this perfect archetype that we see. And this is literally what happened. Watching documentaries and listening to the audiobook of the Jonestown book that you recommended, that's literally what happened. This insane notion of, you know, by any means necessary, we're going to find equality, and we're literally going to use black bodies. And these, you know, that was the majority of people who died in Jonestown. And I'm not one of those people. I'm not going to say, oh, you know, when a terrorist attack happens, the people we should think of is what about how this is going to affect the Muslim community? People are going to be Islamophobic. I'm not trying to do that. But it is something I think we should recognize, that actually even are these Marxists and these people who, you know, consider themselves champions for the quote unquote lower class or the blacks or the people of color, they're doing way more harm to these people than we ever could.
Absolutely.
They were better off before the 60s. They're happy by themselves.
Absolutely. One of the things that people fail to, on our side, fail to push is the fact that the race-mixing experiment has totally failed. You know, the idea in the 50s when I was a kid was that, well, we're going to desegregate the schools, then we're going to have school busing, and we're going to mix all these people up, and the blacks will become like white kids. Well, they won. They got their way. And this experiment has been tried all over America in thousands of school systems. And I like to ask liberals who still believe in this stuff, or let multiculturalists and conservatives too believe in it. I like to ask them, have you ever seen a study? Can you give me a study that showed that after mixing the schools, the racism in the schools, that black academic performance and black scores on SAT scores and black IQs increased? And they'll look at you and they'll say, well, of course that happened. And I'll tell them, no, it didn't happen. I said, you haven't heard of such a study. And if there had been a study like that, there were a bunch of studies showing that after the busing experiment, for instance, in Charlotte, North Carolina, where for a huge area, like 50 miles in diameter, all the schools were balanced. They were all 30% black and 7% white. If you had a study 5 years after that federal imposed race mixing program, black SAT scores had jumped by 80 and black IQs had jumped to 93 from 85 and so on, that study would be reported in the New York Times. It would have been on Dan Rather's 60 Minutes. It'd be everywhere to show how it had worked. We never heard about those studies. We pursued a program at enormous expense. It probably cost us certainly billions, probably trillions of dollars at this point, for a program that has no statistical proof that it will work. And it won't work. It hasn't worked. You know, the Martin Luther King solution to black problems was tried. Martin Luther King, whatever virtues he had in addition to his vices, was simply wrong. His program did not work and did not help black people.
Yeah, I've heard this many times that, especially with affirmative action, they get into somewhere like Yale or Harvard, and the dropout rates are insane because they can't hack it, because they're in a place that's way above where they should be. And there are surely on the bell curve blacks who could, you know, hack it in Harvard, but the ones that, you know, they're just shoving everyone in there. And so they drop out and they do worse than if they just went to a college that fit their level. So, yeah, I agree 100%. Really quick, to bring it back to the I guess the greater question of how you like that you don't shy away from hierarchy. You like the balance. You don't think we should just kind of artificially select people. I agree. So with the part of why I'm not a Western European supremacist is that I look and maybe I think that Eastern European peoples, it seems like the West is burning the candle at both ends, and the East, maybe they don't progress as much, but they have a steady thing, and they're still who they are. They're going to be ethnically the same people. And maybe one of the things that I've started to question recently, maybe we need those kinds of soccer hooligans that these British upper class people scoff at. They say, oh, the stupid Brexit people, you know, the people who are yelling, you know, Tommy, Tommy, Tommy Robinson, oi, oi, oi. We have a lot of that in Russia as well. You know, again, the Gopniks, but those are the people who aren't going to wait. That, you know, in Germany or in Sweden, you hear these insane stories in the news where a little boy was molested, raped, anally raped by a Muslim, and they let him off because, oh, he didn't understand that was against the rules or all this kinds of stuff. And there's a video of Putin talking about this. He said, like, I don't understand that. This is insane. You need to protect your children. In Russia, they're very corrupt. I get it. You know, people bribe. I'm not saying it's perfect here. I'm not going to champion this and say it's like this utopia. They have their problems, of course, but that's something that just wouldn't happen. that if they heard this, they would just vigilante. They would go up and they would just beat the living crap out of these foreigners who are molesting a kid. They just wouldn't put up with it. And I think we need, again, there's that balance. So maybe they can be blockheaded and a little bit too nationalistic and you know, manipulated. But I think that's a healthy society. We need everybody in the hierarchy. So yeah, I don't shy away from that.
What do you think the most salient personality feature of modern Americans is? Well, what character feature do Americans have that is the most remarkable thing? You mentioned individualism. What do you think is the most remarkable thing?
I'm kind of jaded now because when I go back, I'm just like, God, they're fat slobs.
I'll tell you what I think. I think the most remarkable feature of the modern American personality is passivity. There has never been a more passive people in human history. You mentioned the little boy molested by the Muslims, which is quite common among Muslims, by the way. Well, to continue on that same subject, everybody knows the fate of young white males who go to prison. You know, that they are sexually molested by blacks. The guy that dragged the black guy to death in Jasper, Texas, according to the warden of his prison, was raped by four blacks the first day he was in jail. He was a working class white guy. His parents had enough money where he didn't get a public defender. They didn't have enough money to hire a lawyer, so he got sent to jail for basically a first offense burglary charge that a black would never have been sent to jail for. And the first day, he was raped by four blacks. According to the warden of his prison, he was raped daily for the next 6 months, 180 days. And he comes out of jail, surprisingly, according to the media, with a pathological hatred of black people, which any sensible person could have predicted. But that story is not an unusual story in America. I've had clients raped in jail. There are probably well over 1 million or 2 million white American males walking around the mall, passing you in the public grocery store, who have been sexually molested by blacks in jail. One out of every 10 white men will spend significant periods of time in jail, and it's skewed where most of them are young guys. Certainly you and I, and I think virtually everyone listening to our conversation, deplores the murder of that black guy in Jasper, Texas, by dragging him behind the car or truck or whatever they did to him. But in a sense, the odd thing here is not that there's one white guy who went berserk after that treatment and killed a black guy in Jasper, Texas. The amazing thing is that millions of white guys have suffered this with no reaction. Can you imagine the time of the American Revolution? If King George had garrisoned America with British soldiers who were sexually molesting young white males all over the country, how long would it have been taken to have a Declaration of Independence? Not very long. But modern Americans will put up with anything. Something as dramatic as these horrific sexual molestations. There have been several cases that have been sent to me by people who heard me talk about this, of white guys who were innocent, who were put in jail, let proven to be innocent, who died of AIDS because of what they experienced in jail. There's no outcry from the churches about that. You won't find a clergyman complaining about the treatment of white prisoners in jail. And, you know, Jesus said, "I was in prison and you visited me." The churches are not doing that. They're like the Levite in the parable of the Good Samaritan. All these preachers and priests and Catholic bishops, they're all walking by on the opposite side of the road when it comes to white males being sexually molested in jail and dying of AIDS. That's the real moral, the level of moral depravity, of public moral depravity in the American society. And yeah, I don't think Russians would put up with it. I don't think Poles would. Germans would. Germans are so run down, they'll put up with anything. There's nothing left of them. They're psychologically ruined.
Yeah, it's heartbreaking, especially the Germans. It's funny you brought that up because I just looked this up. The American History X, the movie, of course, obviously it's propaganda, yada, yada. But the Aryan Brotherhood rapes the main character. It's been a while since I've seen it, but that's a famous scene. And I was looking, it was actually on Countercurrents, the website, and someone in the comments section said, we all know this is largely a black on white thing. I'd actually never heard that. Every day there's a new thing that I'm learning now that I'm kind of woke and that I just never even thought about. And you go, wait a minute, mate, that's probably true.
It will always be this way. I mean, you'll learn more and more. It's like what happened to me after I learned we've been lied to about McCarthy. I had to peel off layer after layer of the onion to find how many times we've been lied to in just shocking ways, like this thing here. But by the way, I'll tell you this. The police authorities in America have on occasion actually used the threat of being raped as a means of coercing white males into confessing to crimes or cooperating with the prosecution against other people. If you don't sign this, if you don't say what we want you to say, we're going to put you in a cell and you're going to be Rufus's girlfriend for the next week. That's the level. That's the real America. That's what America really is.
That's literally out of the Turner Diaries. It sounds like dystopian insanity, but that's what they talk about, and that's the world we live in, the clown world. So is this true, by the way? Do white gangs use it against blacks, or is it specifically?
No. I don't know why blacks are into that. I mean, clearly most of them are not homosexuals. I've heard things like it's a way of humiliating and persecuting people you don't like, but it would surprise me that the heterosexual males would even get an erection dealing with other males. But apparently they're so highly sexed that they can do this. So no, I don't think whites are doing it. No, I don't think that's. I think there's probably a higher level of same-sex sex in a jail among white people as there are in general, but I don't think it's anywhere near what it is in terms of the molestation of white prisoners by black prisoners. It's a terrible thing, but there are so many other things that just jump off the page at you. The cost of race mixing, the ruining of the cities. Right now we're enjoying. One of the for a few good trends in America is the gentrification of in-town areas where whites will once again be able to live close to work. But, you know, when you come to Atlanta someday and we actually meet, you don't even need to see it. You live in America. I could take you to the bridge over any of the expressways during rush hour traffic, and you can see the cars backed up 20 and 30 miles coming in the morning and going home at night. All of this is because of the race mixing failed social experiment that was going to make black people into white people by mixing everything up. The cost of this to white people is colossal. You know, just running the car 30 miles each way, you know, it's basically about 3 gallons a day. You know, that's about $10 a day. Figuring 250 work days, it's $2,500 a year imposed on these people just in terms of the financial cost of the gasoline, not counting wear and tear and depreciation of the car. And then above all, they spend, it's very common. I have many friends here who spend an hour and a half coming to work and an hour and a half going home 5 days a week, 15 hours a week, almost two full work days. But whites do it. They never catch on. There's not a whimper from the whites about the sacrifices they incur but because of this race-fixing thing. And whites are just, I don't know, they just seem retarded to me. Certainly Southern whites, and I'm saying this again as a Southerner, so Southerners listening to this, don't get mad at me because I'm a loyal.
Hey, your subconscious is listening. Don't say these negative things about yourself.
I know. But, you know, the Southerners have the idea that politics is something that happens every 2 years on election day. That's the level of Anglo-Saxon Southerners' political awareness. You and I know there are other ethnic groups, chief and foremost the Jews. They know that politics is something that takes place 24/7, and that by election day, everything has been decided. Election day basically doesn't matter because of all of the propaganda in the schools, of the media, of the preparations, of the voter registration drive, all these things. The Southerners don't get that. I've never seen a white voter registration drive in the South or anywhere in the nation. The Republicans had a voter registration drive in the areas where they get their votes in New Jersey about 20 years ago. The Justice Department threatened an investigation because they said it was racially discriminatory because the registrars were working in predominantly white areas, and the Republicans dropped it. In Georgia, when Stacey Abrams, the black militant, won the Democrat nomination, she registered 250,000 blacks in 8 weeks. The Republicans never conducted a single voter registration drive because they're for two reasons. They're afraid of being called racist. And the second thing is the Republican Party is completely owned by big business, and they don't want working class whites voting. And so, you know, we're just retarded. The white people just don't get it. There's a lawyer buddy of mine. He's actually worked with me. He's a nice guy, a real Aryan, got three beautiful children, beautiful wife. He was telling me that he was having to move to Cherokee County because of demographic pressures in the area of Cobb County he lived in. And he also complained that in his private club, his country club, the city of Atlanta had forced them now to take blacks in. And he, by the way, he voted for this. He said, well, you know, I had to vote for that because the city was going to take our pouring license and we wouldn't have been able to get cocktails. And I pointed out to him, you know, in a few years, your daughters are going to be dating guys and they're going to be at that club and they're going to be at debutante parties. And the other members' black children, the black members' boys, are going to come over and ask to dance with your daughter. And he said, oh, that would never happen. I said, it's going to happen. And when it happens, you're not going to say anything. He said, oh, I would never allow that. I said, you would. You are unwilling to put up with losing a pouring license. And you're willing to admit these people into a situation in which your daughters will be exposed to mixing with them and openly marrying them because you didn't want to have to carry your own liquor to the country club. And I said, the reason this happens is because you've never made a donation to any white cause or any white candidate. You never sent $100 to David Duke. And that's why you have to move to Cherokee County and lose tens of thousands of dollars and drive an extra hour a day to and from work. That's why your daughters will end up dancing with black teenagers in 10 years because you are unable to think in political terms the way blacks and Jews and Mexicans and all these other groups are able to think. Amazingly, he still talks to me because he's a good guy. He's a tough guy. You can take it. But I think he knew what I was saying was the truth.
So this is something that I think is... I would take it as a compliment, I guess, but this is, I think, our weakness, is I think we think very straight. And so we don't understand, like, when you look at movies that are from right-wingers who are trying to, you know, like the Dinesh D'Souza kind of stuff, or this new movie came out, it's called Unplanned. Let's not get into Dinesh D'Souza. But so a white guy, I think, did the Unplanned. It's about abortion. And it's just in your face. It's very direct. It's not subversive at all. And I think that's because the people... I guess on our side, never mind the right, they tend to be more conservative, but whatever, these, you know, racially aware, just anti-Marxist kind of people, we're more straight. And we want to see some statistics and charts and look at the FBI data and go, oh, okay, yeah, let's do this. And so we can't really put ourselves in the shoes, and we don't understand how important media is. Like you said, politics is 24/7. Politics is downstream from culture. And all day when you watch these commercials with the race mixing and this and that, all the Marxist subtle things, that has an effect. And we like to think, no, and we kind of ignore the subconscious that it has any influence. And I think that's why there's a strength with the Jewish community. They understand the power of that. And they really put all of their money.
Do they ever?
Yeah, yeah.
A friend of mine pointed out that if you go online and you type in, you Google Jewish networking, just look what comes up. Hundreds of thousands, you know, Jewish singles, Jewish cooking classes, Jewish Hadassah meetings. Yeah, you type in something like German America, German networking, Polish network, Presbyterian network, nothing. You know, no wonder they're winning.
Yeah, and I think part of it, to speak on the retarded thing, I still am in some ways, and I'm like we talked about, we're slowly unpeeling the onion. But one thing that in retrospect seems so like I'm shocked that it was even the way I used to think now that I'm kind of quote unquote woke. It was listening to Ann Coulter's book, Adios America.
And what a great book. What a great book.
That really woke me up. And the fact that I had never thought about it, there's this false dichotomy that, you know, it's the kosher sandwich kind of a thing where it's like, okay, you either get another 9/11. And I remember having these debates with family and friends and stuff. This was the debate of 2001, 2002. They say, okay, you either get another 9/11 or you give up all your freedoms, Patriot Act. That's it. And so you go, well, I don't know. And you literally, you're in their paradigm and you can't think outside the box. And you think you're a free speech kind of guy and you're, you know, you're outside the box. No, man, this is, oh, you just stop the immigration. It's problem solved. Ann Coulter. And same thing. I think we've been so beaten over the head with media and academia and the people who control these things that they act like it's inevitable. When you see a lot of people, conservatives, they say, hey, dude, whites are going to be a minority. It's inevitable. And again, Ann Coulter saying that, and it sounds so stupid. It was very simple. But to hear someone else say it broke me out of my I don't know, like my coma, my coma, that, no, that's not inevitable. We've put in these policies, these immigration policies that are doing the browning of America, and we can reverse it. And you and I may agree that now it's a little bit too late and we're kind of fatalistic, but that's another thing. The fact that they act like there's nothing you can do and that this country is not yours is just, you know.
That was in the South during the desegregation thing. That was the fear. Oh, there's nothing we can do. Oh, you know, we don't have any power. There's nothing we can do. The South could have put a stop to desegregation very easily. And this is something that's wrong with our movement. We think in terms of dramatic things like race wars, which I think is coming. My own prediction is that that's just going to be a horrific explosion in the next 10 or 20 years, unimaginably horrific. But, you know, there are other ways to deal with this. And, you know, the South would have been better off if it had a Gandhi figure in 1861 rather than Jefferson Davis. And, you know, and the same in the desegregation crisis in the 50s and 60s. They could just... passive resistance, refuse to pay taxes, refuse to serve in the army, you know, go on juries and just paralyze the jury system, you know, award billion-dollar verdicts against these big companies that are betraying us, like Coca-Cola. Get on those juries. They're depending upon ordinary white people to hold the line in these damage cases. If I got on a jury and involved something like Bank of America or Budweiser, I would spend the whole time that you're just adding up all the zeros I could add after the first figures in the verdict that I would hand on, just crush them out of existence. There are all kinds of ways that passive resistance could have stopped this. And, you know, the police in New York, that horrible de Blasio character was palling around with the let's hate the police, Black Lives Matter movement. You know, there was a cop that was killed by blacks. In these Black Lives Matter things. And de Blasio actually had the gall to show up at the funeral because politicians love to pal around with cops. You know, they love pictures of them with cops because the voters love that. They love cops. All kinds of people love cops in their uniforms, and they love that. But so anyway, he decided it was time for a photo op to show up at the cops and show how much he cared for this cop that had been killed. You may remember, all the cops in this unions are actually helpful to us in this case. When that ass showed up, every cop at the funeral turned his chair around and turned his back on de Blasio. Now that's a real statement of resistance, far beyond anything that's been done by any of these alt-right groups.
Amen.